What's up guys, Omni here. You guys know how it goes, another day, another video. Last night I tweeted, I sleep, what recent news, topics, tweets, videos y'all want me to talk about tomorrow. Hey guys, today is Wednesday, January 12th, sorry for no video on Monday. I was getting sick, I felt a little under the weather, I was kind of worried, I thought I got COVID or something, that Omicron, I haven't even been outdoors doing much, so I was just like, wow, did that joke just like creep into my freaking apartment like a freaking like gas fume or something? Like, bro, nah, we're all good. I'm feeling much better. I don't know. Maybe it's, you know how just sometimes you just don't be feeling good? Like I've been getting migraines. I don't know. Sometimes you don't need to be sick to be sick. So that's basically what I was feeling like. Anyway, we have a lot of news to talk about since we missed on Monday. A bunch of things with DMCA and streamers and people going wild and watching anime and other things as well. So yeah, we're going to go ahead and get catched up and talk about all that stuff. No sponsor for the day, so we're just going to go ahead and jump into today's topics. But if you guys want to, I do have a Patreon open. A lot of you guys always been asking me, hey, Omni, do you have a Discord? Or hey, Omni, how can I support you? Whatever. I got a Patreon. Patreon.com/InfernoOmni. Link in the description below if you guys want to come through the Discord and hang out. Or if you want to come to my ultra secret room where we, you know, like watch anime, but not on Twitch, but in a place where there's an actual watch party. Anyway, that's it. Let's get into today's topics and yeah, allow me to lay in on you. So guys, remember last episode with the whole Etika Punks thing where people was making NFTs? This one person made an NFT of Etika. The Just Dan Dan said, reposting this again for tomorrow. Let it be known that trash has been taken out permanently. So the account that I asked you guys to basically mass report for being so terrible for making an NFT of Etika is gone. I actually had seen this tweet right here last night, and now as of this morning, or it's gone. He's officially off Twitter. So just a quick update, guys. We did it. If you guys signed on Twitter and you guys reported this account, I really appreciate it because it was completely abhorrent and terrible for what they were doing. So Emily Boston said, comedian and TV personality Bob Saget suddenly passed away at the age of 65. This was his final tweet. Yep. The legend, the man, the myth himself, Bob Saget, the everyone's dad from Full House. I never watched Fuller House, but I used to watch Full House all the time when I was a kid, man, and sad to see that this guy has passed away at 65. It seems like it was sudden. At first, I was kind of worried if it was like Omicron or something had gotten to him or he was sick, but they found out that he was unresponsive in his hotel room a couple days ago. And yeah, now he's gone. I think the weirdest thing that I found out when it came to Bob Saget was the fact that he had a dirty mouth. Because he was everyone's, like, you know, dad on Full House. And then when you see him out of that zone, he actually loves cursing. He loves telling dirty jokes. He's one of us. He has a sailor mouth, but he's just absolutely destructive with it. So it was completely against the personality that we had seen on TV. But yeah, man, rest in peace. I used to watch him on Full House. I used to watch him on, I think he was the host for America's Most Funny Videos or something like that too as well. But yeah, legend has just passed away. So rest in peace to the guy. Okay, so JSC John said, Drake ahead of the game stops a woman from trapping him. Some superhero stuff here. Okay. Instagram model ready to sue after Drake allegedly put hot sauce in a condom. What? Why did he put a hot sauce in a condom? What? Okay, hold on. Let's read this. It reads, allegedly, Drake and the IG model allegedly met up on Instagram and the two decided to link up a few weeks ago. The model and Drake had a romantic encounter and what happened next was, well, crazy. After the party, they went back to his hotel. They smoked weed for a bit and he asked if she wanted to have sex. She said he was very intent on ensuring things were consensual. They started with a bit of foreplay. He rubbed and okay. He then went to the bathroom and came out with a condom on. She said he's about 7 inches thick and cut. They effed for about 20 minutes. He mostly hit it from the back and then he came in the condom. Immediately after, he went back into the bathroom to dispose of it. She fished the condom out of the trash, untied it, and put the opening into her vajayjay. What? Oh my God. Wait. This gotta be a cap. That's nasty. But at the same time, I can see someone trying to get knocked up by Dre and have his kid and then get like a cut, you know, millions and millions of dollars. Boy, was she in for a surprise. She said it felt like pouring hot lava into her vajayjay. She screamed and Drake ran into the bathroom. He admitted that he poured a packet of hot sauce in the condom to kill the sperm. Is that even a thing? Now the Instagram model is threatening to sue Drake. Bro. Wow, that's absolutely wild. Again, this is all allegedly, so I'm just reading the story because I did see this trending on Twitter. But if this did happen, I mean, you got to be safe on these streets. If you Drake, you know, you got to keep your offspring potential, you know, well kept, security, dispose of it, obviously. You can see that some people would probably go through great lengths to take it. But yeah, there's no way that an Instagram model can sue Drake for that. That's just ridiculous. Is this real? I gotta stop playing, bro. It says Drake be like, he doing whoa to the Plan B one step and instead pointing to the freaking Red Hot original frame. This joint said Drake in the next room when he heard the scream. Anyway, that's Drake pouring hot sauce in his condom and the IG model apparently suing him. Let me know how you guys feel. All right, guys, we got to talk about this tweet really fast that went viral January 10th. It has to deal with men and crying and a woman who's basically suggesting that she is not turned on by men crying. Okay, Team June and Cornbread said this, and a lot of you guys pointed me to this tweet. It's a tweet right here that reads this. While I don't want men to completely avoid it, seeing a man cry does turn me off. You guys already know this is about to be a wild ride. This is just the first sentence, and just off the first sentence alone, you already know this is gonna be a wild ride. There's almost 10,000 quote retweets and 1,700 likes, which means this person has been ratioed into infinity. I'm seeing the pendulum swing from quote men shouldn't cry to quote a man crying has zero effect on his attractiveness, and neither of these are true. We've come across this, you know, every now and then when, you know, women on Twitter will be like, I don't want my man to drink Kool-Aid. I don't think men should drink juice. I don't think men should give hugs. I don't think men should touch other men and give them hugs. I don't think men should breathe. I don't think men should laugh after 2 seconds. There was an entire list, and there's a tweet for all of these, by the way, where some woman, and then the tweet would blow up talking about like, you know what? I don't think it's attractive for a man to XYZ. And now, you know, she's saying that I just don't want men to cry because it's a turnoff. Like somehow by me crying, you getting turned off by one day. Like I'm trying to feel my feelings. And you're like, can you stop? This is not hot. This is not turning me on. Like, it's not supposed to. Whoever is crying, bro. Go give that person a freaking hug. Anyway, let's read a little bit more. I'm curious. Let's read a little bit more into this nonsense. Let's get deeper into the chaos. Okay. He said, there are times when it is warranted for a man to cry in front of a female potential partner. It's weird, in my opinion, seeing a woman use the word female, because most women don't like to be called females, but I guess women can call each other females. I don't know. I can't say when and why, because this is a highly contextual example of when it would turn me off. During early days, unless something traumatic happened, like we were on the Titanic. All right. I'm about to tap out. This person is beyond help. This person just compared and said, it's okay to cry as long you're on a sinking ship and you are about to die. The next statement says, examples of when I suspect it would have little to no effect. I guess little to no effect, crime having an effect on her horniness levels or whatever, or bring us closer. So saying that it would have no effect. Like if you cry on funerals, if you cry with injuries, if you cry for loss, financial effects, or periods of stress. Like, dog, what is she talking about? To be clear, I am speculating that these are specific to me, not instructions or rules for when it's okay for men to cry. I imagine this is highly variable depending on the person and relationship, but I'm skeptical of any woman who says it doesn't affect attractiveness. So, okay. I'm gonna read a little bit more because this tweet blew up a little bit. She said, women are biologically wired to cry more than men. I should be able to trust a male partner's level-headedness and joint decisions when I'm beside myself with grief, pregnant, in labor, sleep deprived, sick, etc. This is very attractive in a male partner! Conversely, if a male partner cries in a situation where I think I wouldn't cry, I sense that he is not dependable in a crisis, and I will be in charge of making decisions for both of us. Since I have higher estrogen levels, this asks me to exert a tremendous amount of restraint. This person is garbage. I'm guessing this person is most likely single. This is one of the worst takes I've seen this year so far. We're only 12 days into the year, so I think this takes the cake. Anyway, if you read through the rest of that thread, she starts backtracking. She starts trying to dial it back and be like, actually, men should cry more. It's actually okay to cry more. I'm not trying to offend anybody or criticize anybody, bro. Like, this, you know, first of all, imagine you looking at a man crying and thinking like, wow, this is not hot. Like, bro, somebody is crying, okay? figure out what is going wrong with them. If you care about this person, you need to understand what exactly is going on that's making them cry and that's making them feel distraught. If your first point is like, man, Thomas, I can't believe you're crying. This is not a turn on for me. This is not hot. I don't think we're going to have sex. Like, that's that. Your mind is already kind of twisted. I'm going to be completely frank. I cry every time I watch anime, almost every single freaking time. One Piece specifically. I don't know why. Something about the music, when something is really nice happening or beautiful happening or even sad, for whatever reason, the waterworks happen. Okay. I don't really cry like on the daily, like at all. Like, nothing really happens where, like, I'm just like, boom, I just burst out into tears. Or even if something bad happens, I usually don't cry. But for whatever reason, anime and some movies too, weddings. Weddings absolutely destroy me. I don't know what it is, but that feeling of just being very happy for somebody, right? Either extreme happiness or just mellow anime music, drama, sadness, whatever, starts making the waterworks come out, and I don't know why, and I can't control it. And it feels good. I like it. I don't mind it, and I don't care. I don't feel bad about it. Apparently, she won't think it's hot, you know, at a wedding, and I'm over here tearing up because one of my best friends is getting married, you know, like, how dare you express emotions through the way of actual tears? Anyway, guys, that's the tweet that was going viral a couple of days ago, like 2 days ago, about, you know, men not being able to cry. Let me know how you guys feel about it. Okay, I need to figure out if this is a cap or not, because Shockwave said apparently two cops got fired for going to catch a Snorlax instead of stopping a robbery. Are you telling me two cops, they got a robbery report and they were like, hold up, I'm playing Pokemon Go and let me catch this Snorlax real fast. You know, to be honest, I don't know how rare Snorlax is in Pokemon Go, but it's rare enough for apparently two cops not doing their duties. Let me read into this. Hold up. This is on NPR News. It says an appeals court in California upheld the firing of two former LAPD officers for playing Pokemon Go rather than responding to a nearby robbery. Both officers were pursuing a Snorlax and ignored the call for backup. How did they even get this information in the first place? Did the cops like admit to this? They were just like, so guys, where were you? What did you do? And one of the cops was like, we was trying to catch the Snorlax. Like, how did they become privy of this information? So I found some official jargon. I'll just read it really fast. Based on interviews and the DICVS recording, Detective McClanahan concluded petitioners willfully failed to respond to the robbery and attempted to conceal the facts by, quote, placing themselves code 6 somewhere else. So ain't no freaking way. Not only we're not coming to the robbery to save people and do our job, but we're going to say that we were doing a code 6. Sorry, sir. Code 6. Can't help you. Sorry. See ya. And then, you know, start catching the Snorlax, dog. That's wild. After carefully listening to the DICVS recording a number of times, Detective McClanahan also became concerned that petitioners were playing the Pokemon Go video game while on duty the day of the robbery. The recording showed at approximately 6:09, just 5 minutes after Officer Lozano said screw it to checking in with his communications about the robbery call, Officer Mitchell alerted Lozano that Snorlax just popped up at 46 and Lemmert. Bro, this sounds like a freaking skit, like an SNL skit, dog. After noting that Lemmert doesn't go all the way to 46, Lozano responded, oh, you know what I can do? I'll go down 11th and swing up on Crenshaw. I know that way I can get to it. Mitchell suggested a different route, then told Lozano, we got 4 minutes. Man, these guys had their priorities and order, man. They was like, look, robbery attempt? I ain't trying to get into that life. I ain't trying to risk my life. Let's just go catch this Snorlax instead. For approximately the next 20 minutes, the DICVS captured petitioners discussing Pokemon as they drove to different locations where the virtual creatures apparently appeared on their mobile phones. On their way to Snorlax location, Officer Mitchell alerted Officer Lozano that a Togetic just popped up, noting it was on Crenshaw. So these guys are just on the force driving around playing Pokemon Go. That's it. They're just sitting here just like, hey, where are we going? Where's next? Where are we going? They're not even working, dog. They just like, screw it. I'm just going to play Pokemon Go all day and people can call and ask me to do my job, but I'm not about that life. So guys, the saga ends here. It says, after Mitchell apparently caught the Snorlax, exclaiming, got him. Petitioners agreed to go get the Togetic and drove off, bro. This is what happened to Ash Ketchum when he grew up. This is Ash Ketchum IRL. When their car stopped again, the DICVS recorded Mitchell saying, don't run away. While Lozano described how he buried it and ultra balled the Togetic before announcing, got him. It's funny because this is actual like verbiage from the document. from these claims, right? You and I know this is what people say when they're catching Pokemon, right? But these quote retweets, these guys were talking and enunciating their entire life about catching these Pokemon Go people, not knowing, I guess, they're going to be recorded, it was going to be brought up, adding, "Holy crap, man, this thing is fighting the crap out of me." Eventually, Mitchell claimed, "Holy crap, finally," apparently in reference to capturing the Togetic, and he remarked, "The guys are going to be so jealous." Oh man, petitioners then agreed to return to the 7-Eleven to end their watch. On the way, Mitchell remarked, "I got you a new Pokemon today, dude." So, dang, man, just the gamers, the guys, you know, just playing games, being police officers, sucks. One of us, but damn, not anymore. I mean, now they're no longer employed. But yeah, those are the two cops who were playing Pokemon Go and then got fired. It sounds like a fever dream. It sounds like a skit. It sounds like it's not real. And yet here we are reading the actual wordage from it. Sucks to suck, but it is what it is. Shouldn't have got caught. Next time, keep your thoughts to yourself, okay? This isn't an actual goddamn anime. You know what I'm saying? Anyway, let me know how you guys feel about the subject. Bloody James said, "Pokimane recently got a 48-hour ban on Twitch for watching anime on stream. It looks like the streamers are now just pushing the boundaries of copyright and are happily taking the punishment." So yeah, if you guys don't know, Pokimane, a couple days ago, I think this was Friday, she was watching Avatar: The Last Airbender, which is a excellent taste in the show. If you're gonna watch a show and get banned for 48 hours, I think Avatar: The Last Airbender is a good one to watch. Anyway, she had made this tweet afterwards and said, "The Fire Nation attacked, confirmed 48-hour suspension. See you guys Monday morning for a 12-hour comeback stream," which was last Monday, which she's already done. So yeah, she got banned over the weekend and then she came back, and that's basically it. However, there are multiple Twitch streamers doing this. Toast, Disguised Toast, you guys know him from usually Among Us or Team Fight Tactics, probably Among Us, member of Offline TV, just joined Twitch, and now he has been banned for an entire month for watching 25 episodes of Death Note. Almost reached the end of Death Note, if you know what I mean. Anyway, he said here, "Welp, looks like I'll be seeing you guys in a month." So there's this thing. I think XQC was also watching Hunter x Hunter on his stream as well. I don't know if he's been banned or not, but there's this thing where these Twitch streamers are now and are just basically playing with DMCA and watching full-blown anime copyrighted on their Twitch streams in front of tens of thousands of people, only to get banned, as if they want to go to jail, as if they want to get banned. Like, it's kind of weird. So that's the what, right? I get the what. I get what they are doing. I get Twitch streamers are going ahead and they're trying to get banned. This isn't anything new, by the way. The person that basically originated this whole get banned system and then take a vacation was Amarath. You guys don't remember Amarath, who just bought a pool company or whatever, but she is the one of the infamous streamers who was riding on the daggone banana at one point in time, and that had to get removed from the Twitch platform, and she would push that as far as possible. On Friday, she would go ahead and do something that would get her banned and get her, you know, 48-hour suspension, and then on Monday, she would come back and she would take a break, and then when she did this, you know, she would be, you know, banned on Twitch, and then people would talk about it. I'd talk about it. It'd be on this little streamer thing that says streamer bans. It would turn up like news thing, and then she would just come back on Monday and just continue. So it's like, instead of just not making videos, instead of just not streaming, it seems like at least Amarath, she was strategically getting banned and then taking a vacation. So now I'm kind of curious to see, is this what, you know, Twitch streamers are doing? Are they strategically trying to take a vacation so they're trying to get banned so that, you know, like me, us, we're just talking about it? Because, I mean, it's a genius idea if it works. But also, it's playing with fire. Boy, Tim, we watched this clip. It's only 30 seconds. He has something to talk about it. But the whole point is that whatever it is that they're doing and their why, which I'm going to try to see if I can figure out for today with you guys on stream, it could have an impact on the entire community. If you guys don't know, YouTube has already went through this several times. There was an event called an adpocalypse where ads were pulling out left and right for, I'm not even going to go in and get into that, but basically infected a whole bunch of people. But the smaller YouTubers get affected the most, because the biggest ones who are, you know, creating this adpocalypse, they're not worried. They don't lose money, or if they lose revenue, they lose income, they're fine. They can make content for free and can just keep going, and they can survive the adpocalypse. But a lot of like mid-level streamers or YouTubers and stuff can't survive any event that might start taking money in pockets in a way, and kind of people are kind of worried that this might disturb the system and the ecosystem, and it might create something that will, you know, not benefit smaller streamers, but you know, the big streamers will be fine, because even if they get their channel completely banned, they have enough money to last a lifetime.
YouTube has a system implemented for situations like this. Twitch also needs to have something. Okay. They can't just be like, okay, you're banned. Okay, 2 days. All right, you're back. You know what I'm saying? Oh, you're banned up 2 days. All right, you're back. What's going to happen? And here's the problem. What's probably going to happen now is Twitch is going to make something, and it might honestly come down hard on smaller creators. That's what happened on YouTube, yeah. Right? They had this whole thing happen. YouTubers were doing it. They got cracked down on it, and it hurt a lot of YouTubers that were just smaller channels.
Yeah. So quick explanation in case you guys don't know about YouTube and copyright strikes. When you get copyright striked on YouTube, usually your video gets taken down or completely demonetized. Either A, all the monetization from your content goes directly to the copyright owner, or B, the video just gets blocked and you can't see it. Whereas on Twitch, it seems like you still make the money from the stream that you do. Right? You stream and you get all the donos and you get all the ad revenue. Everything that you got in seems like it still comes into you. However, it just seems like you get like a 48-hour slap on the wrist and you're gone. Now that brings the question of the difference between Pokimane and Toast. Why did Pokimane only get a 2-day ban? Why did Toast get a 1-month ban? Did it have something to do with the fact that Toast was watching Death Note? Maybe different companies, DMCA laws, copyright strikes. Maybe he watched more of it. I'm not 100% certain, but I do know that a 2-day slap is not significant. But a 1-month slap, that's a big boy. That's a big chunky wongy. So, all right, guys, let's do some investigative digging work, because I don't know. I mean, I haven't watched Toast in terms, I haven't seen a clip of him saying why he's trying to get banned. But I did read this from the streamer ban's tweet. It said here, the best part are the people who don't watch Toast being mad. Bilal's fans just finding it funny because Toast literally started streaming anime with the end goal of getting banned, is what somebody is saying underneath the reply of him actually getting banned from streamer ban. In which case, this person asks what everyone's thinking, why? Is it to get attention and more views when he comes back? In which this guy, Toast Jail Era, said, and I don't know if this is completely true, but we're just going to read into it. It seems like it's getting a lot of traction. We're going to keep doing a little bit more, but I don't know for sure. Well, really, his goal was to push boundaries of React content and start the conversation about DMCA. Okay, he fully intended on getting banned, but Pokey got banned first and he felt bad about that. Then said he's going to go until he gets banned too. So, okay. This don't make no damn sense. Pushing the boundaries of React content and starting a conversation about DMCA. You can just literally start a conversation. That's what content is for. I can literally make a YouTube channel and say, hey guys, let's have a conversation about DMCA. But instead he's deciding to martyr himself. I don't quite get it. I don't think that's very logical to get yourself banned watching content in order to start a conversation from DMCA. I don't agree with that. So guys, I looked over the place, I scoured the internet. I couldn't find out the why. I couldn't find a clip of Pokimane or Toast or anybody talking about why they are doing it. I mean, yeah, they're talking about like there's DMCA laws and copyright strikes, React content and stuff like that, but I haven't seen like a very clear like because XYZ. So okay, this part was kind of interesting. Playing DMCA roulette for clout is what they're saying. Even after Pokey was banned, Sky's Toast made the decision to proceed with his launch party. Why? A lot of people in the Twitch community believe it was a way for Toast to effectively farm clout. He knew he was going to be banned, but he made the same gamble as Pokey and Jarvis. Anyway, this is risky, but it could ultimately pay off if the streamer play their cards, right? If you make an event out of playing Russian roulette with copyrighted content, tens of thousands of viewers might tune in just to see what happens. You could maintain thousands of viewers and receive a slap on the wrist at the end of it all, or you could be putting your streaming career at risk. It all boils down to how large a stream is and what situations like after Twitch. After all, Pokey and Toast were playing the game with a bulletproof vest. That's the biggest thing. Like, that's my annoyance with this entire situation, is that if they are playing a game, it's they're playing with privilege, right? If you got some random streamer out there going out there and watching anime on stream, 25 episodes of Death Note, they're getting evaporated. Their account is just getting banned. Like, there's no way that they're getting like a 2-day, 48-hour slap if you're not Pokimane. You're just gone. You're done, right? So these guys are like, hey, we're huge. We're Twitch streamers. And we're going to be doing something that's crazy illegal. But, you know, it's Twitch. It's the meta. They're not going to give me a 48 buyer. They're not going to permanent ban me. So it's, you're playing with the privilege there. And it's kind of, as a person without privilege, with you guys, smaller streamers looking at this, getting slapped for doing nothing, it's annoying to watch, you know what I mean? So MRF explains why some streamers can get away with the TV meta. It says, as MRF explained to Ludwig, watching TV shows on stream is too risky for some streamers. Quote, I feel like while people who have contracts with Twitch and stuff or are favored heavily by Twitch can get away with it, it's too risky for me to do it, she stated, which is interesting because she's done a lot of other risky things. And it's, yeah, it says it's no surprise that Twitch favors its more lucrative or brand-friendly creators. So guys, we're going to end with this tweet that I asked you guys here on Twitter. I had tweeted, I said, why are top Twitch streamers watching live anime on their streams until they are banned? Am I missing something here? So this entire segment could have been his own episode. We could have done that. But yeah, let's figure out what's going on. Let's see how you guys feel about it. Let's see what you guys think, because essentially it looks like it's a new meta where basically you can farm clout. Essentially, you can come up here, you can get banned for 48 hours, or you can get banned for a month like Sky's Toast, get all the viewership and traction and media and clout for it, take your vacation, take your break, and then I guess when you come back, it'll be a huge comeback stream where you get buttloads of subs and even more viewership than before, right? That's what it's looking like, but I'm trying to see if there's anything else meticulous. Is there a reason for the madness? Is the chaos actually controlled? So my boy Jake Lucky said, because they get slaps on the wrist and get an easy vacation to come back from with even more viewers because of the drama. So it's literally just because of the, is that it? Is that literally it? Because if that is the answer, it's garbage. My boy Anime Uproar, he said, clearly they've never dealt with the kind of copyright trauma that YouTubers deal with, which which is absolutely true, man. Especially if you're an anime YouTuber, guys. Remember we just got finished talking about Totally Not Mark, the guy that got his entire channel freaking nuked for copyright strike and abuse and stuff like that. And so, you know, while YouTubers are over here like trying to tread, you know, thin lines, like here, I replied and said, I got striked for watching 5 seconds of Sesame Street the other day. How the hell is Toast watching 25 episodes of Death Note, LOL? So it's like, YouTubers, we know how copyright strike works. We get striked left and right, and we're trying to dance around like 5 seconds of clips. And these guys are watching full-on seasons of anime. My boy Lythero said, why are they so shocked that they got banned? And why do I see threads giving advice what people can get away with watching? They're on the wrong site. Yeah, I mean, I agree. I'm not sure why people aren't just watching anime, you know, on their TVs offline, like offline TV. This tweet from Uncle Kool-Aid said, because they're filthy rich and don't think they'll have lasting consequences. Found another tweet about the situation. This person, Baru, said, I really am tired of the Twitch meta. Purposely break the rules while acting dumb in the process so you can take a 2-day vacation and then be welcomed back with 3 times viewership plus exposure. All the while, everyone else now has to deal with stricter rules from your dumbassery. Anyway, guys, that's the long and short of the situation. In my opinion, bro, it's a garbage move. Twitch streamers being bored. I don't know. Maybe there's nothing going on. Maybe there's no games or flavor of the month for them to play. Maybe they can't think of any content to create, so they're going ahead and they're, I don't know, pushing boundaries of DMCA and React content because that's just what they want to do and it gives them the free clout and stuff. And I think it's garbage because I don't think they're thinking of the implications that it can have on everybody else. Because, I mean, again, these risks that they are taking are risks that they can take because, number one, A, they have a huge cushion, okay? They're set, usually for life already at this point. So even if something really bad does happen, even if they get a 1-month ejection or break, they'll be fine. And then, and number two, these are the Twitch golden boys and golden girls of the platform, okay? They're not going anywhere, okay? Yes, Toast might get a 1-month ban, but he'll come back and everyone will hype up his return and he'll be completely fine. He's not getting permanently removed. Pokimane's not getting permanently removed. These people are playing around with it and they have the privilege to know that they have a cushion that they are favorited so they can break the rules and break the laws, things that, you know, something that I could do or you would do and you would be completely ejected from the platform, which is not fair and it's not right, and kind of abusing that system in itself is not, in my opinion, not kosher. Some people might say, well, maybe they're doing this so that they can bring equality to all streamers. I doubt it, okay? I doubt any top Twitch streamer is trying to risk their entire career, risk their entire platform getting deplatformed and banned for the sake of everyone having equal laws or equal rules when it comes to DMCA copyright. At the end of the day, the majority of people who come to Twitch, you know, they follow the rules, right? The majority of them just play video games or they react to content that they're allowed to react to. And now, and if some DMCA stuff starts happening where bigger penalties start getting issued out, this is going to hit the middle guys and the smaller guys just much bigger because they don't have that cushion or that protection, okay? There have been plenty of times where you might just be sitting back and you're listening to some lo-fi hip-hop music on Twitch and then suddenly you get striked because you didn't even realize that song was illegal. Or maybe you was watching a YouTube video or whatever or a news channel and there was a clip in the background and you get striked. You didn't even realize that it was DMCA. Except this time, because these guys are pushing DMCA and maybe increasing the awareness of it, the abuse of it, you guys, without the cushion and the protection and the money, could just get yoinked off the platform. GG, GGs, that's it. You know what I'm saying? There's plenty of people all the time who become subject to DMCA accidentally and they don't get their accounts back. I've talked to a lot of them. Some people who are big as well who haven't gotten their accounts back as well. But yeah, that's the long and short of it, guys. Let me know how you guys feel about the topic. Why do you guys think that these guys are doing what they're doing? Do you think it's fine? Do you think it's just funny? Do you think it's meta? Do you think it's problematic? Do you think it's going to lead to something worse? Let me know how you guys feel in the comments below. So Xavier said the CEO and founder of TSM, who is TSM Reginald, under investigation for allegedly abusing employees and players. I heard about this, guys. Okay, if you guys don't know the CEO founder Reginald, I remember when TSM was actually founded, and I believe it was if I recall correctly. No, I can't recall. The last team that I remember, the earliest phase of TSM for League of Legends was like Reginald. I believe it was Dyrus, the odd one. Odd one was jungler. Dyrus was top. And then bot lane was it Double Lift? And I forget the support guy. I know his name. He's very popular, but there was a support guy as well. Was it Double Lift? Was he original ADC? I can't remember. Anyway, it says Riot Games themselves are investigating a top esports team founder over bullying allegations. Andy Reginald Den, the founder of CEO, has been accused of verbal abuse and bullying by employees of esports. Now, if any of you guys actually know Reginald, if you guys have ever been to League of Legends drama in the past or seen him play, this is not surprising at all. Reginald was toxic from the get-go. Like, he was super, super toxic. And there's always been a lot of drama surrounding like TSM and specifically him and his involvement when it came to him being in League of Legends, and then his departure when he eventually decided not to be a part of the team and then put somebody else in place for him. So there's always been drama surrounding Reginald. Then there was years that went by where he just grew his brand, and I guess he just minded his business, took over his own empire, which is a multi-million dollar industry at this point for TSM. Congratulations to him. Now they're TSM FTX or something like that, about like cryptocurrency or space. But yeah, what did he do? What are they talking about bullying and verbal abuse? That's what I kind of want to know. I can see him verbally abusing someone, but what do they mean by bullying? Anyway, I'm going to read a little bit of this article really fast. It reads, one of the esports industry's most prominent leaders is under investigation for workplace misconduct. Current and former employees and esports pros have accused Team Solomid's founder, CEO Andy Den, of verbally abusing and bullying them. Sources tell Wired. Riot Games, which operates the League of Legends Championship Series in which TSM competes, launched an investigation late last year into Den's behavior. TSM also confirmed that it launched its own investigation around the same time. What do you mean TSM launched its own investigation? It's like, is TSM Reginald just going to be investigating himself? Like, no, if that was me, I'd be like, all right, guys, we're going to launch our own investigation. I'd be like, it turns out I ain't do anything. That's... Quote, we are aware of the allegations made about the CEO owner of TSM. Riot Games told Wired over email. Quote, as the league operator, we have engaged the law firm of O'Melveny of Myers LLP to conduct an independent investigation into claims misconduct made against the leader of this team in accordance with standard league process. Dang. Both Riot and Den declined to comment on specific allegations, citing the ongoing investigative process. So it sounds like something went down, right? Something went down, but we need to know what it is and why. And maybe Myth and all these guys at TSM know exactly what's going down. Maybe it has something to do with Double Lift, but it seems like this is now in a case where people can come out and talk about it. And or maybe it gets settled and the people who were involved in it get a nice, lawsuit. You know, they just get paid out for it. For reference, in case you guys don't know about it, Den, who's only 29, kid's not even 30, bro, has led the esports organization since 2009 and is known in the esports community by his gaming handle, Reginald. In 2020, Forbes named TSM the most valuable esports company with an estimated $410 million valuation. Last year, the organization changed its official name to TSM FTX. TSM operates esports teams and has contracts with players, streamers spanning Fortnite, Valorant, Apex, Legends, Super Smash Brothers. I think the only Smash Brothers person they have at this point now is Leffen. And other top games amounting to millions of followers across social media. Most of all, TSM has become synonymous with competitive League of Legends, the biggest esports titles of all time, attracting a fervent international fandom. So here's another interesting paragraph about the situation. It said, four individuals who have worked with TSM tell Wired that the esports organization is dominated by a culture of fear. As far back as 2013, they say Den was known to verbally abuse and yell at players and employees. This sounds like Double Lift is definitely in this somewhere. He has called employees stupid or worthless, two sources say. Two sources recall Den calling employees after hours to scream at them. Three current or former TSM employees say that sometimes Den would ridicule employees for hours. His tirades were often prompted by minor mistakes. Other times, he yelled at employees in front of assembled colleagues as part of an exhibition, says one current employee that Den appeared to take pride in. One former employee recalled hearing Den say he wanted to make an example out of a person he berated publicly. Jesus Christ. I mean, if you know Reginald, this is not a surprise, but I guess just seeing it right now, and it's terrible. Quote, a normal boss who thought you were doing a bad job would give you feedback. At TSM, it was like, this is trash, you're awful, says one current employee. Anyway, guys, long story short, Reginald is a bully. If you guys are part of TSM, the CEO, you know that he was a bully before he was the CEO of TSM and while he was playing. Everyone kind of knows this. It just seems like now they're talking about it. I'm just more curious to see what's happening with TSM and all these players not being a part of TSM. I think the biggest news would be something like if Leffen was no longer part of TSM. He's been on there for a while. There hasn't been a lot happening in the Smash community space, but I'm just very curious to see what happens with TSM. I feel like something might be happening pretty soon. So if any updates come in, I will let you guys know. But yeah, let me know how you guys feel about TSM Reginald being a bully and all these people coming at him and talking about it. But all right, guys, that's all I have for today's video. If you made it to the end, drop a like and subscribe if you guys haven't already. Sorry if I didn't seem a little off or different today. I'm still not feeling 100%. Like, I thought I got COVID, but I don't think I don't have it anymore, but I still don't feel 100%. So I'm gonna keep resting, but I still want to keep making content because it feels weirder not making content. So I'll see you guys soon. I'm gonna go ahead and edit this video as fast as possible and then get some sleep and rest. So I love you guys. You guys stay safe on these streets. Omicron is an all-time high, man. So be careful, okay? Just be careful, all right? And I'll hit y'all up later, all right? All right, peace.